Hey guys, I'm Phil Town from Rule One Investing. And today, I want to talk to you about what's going on with these Robinhood investors, right? And whether or not they're creating a bubble for the rest of us to blow up on. Interesting problem, right? So this is an exciting time to be an investor in the stock market, no doubt about it, especially this last month or so, with all these Robinhood investors stepping in and creating this massive momentum run on several different stocks. So what's really going on here, you guys? Are these Robinhood investors bubbling up stuff that could result in some sort of, you know, systemic risk here that we should be worried about? So let's talk about that. It seems kind of like the goal of Robinhood, and more power to them, has been to give power to the little guy. They just came in with free trading right off the bat and kind of forced the big guys to come down on their prices. And that drove down prices for everybody. It's really been great. So now most everybody can go out there on any of the major brokerage, online brokerage sites, and they get free trading unless you're a professional like some of us, and then you can't because they stick it to us. So, you know what, they give you sometimes free shares of a company, and sometimes they give you free signups, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, Robinhood kind of was tailor-made for kind of a new younger investor in an ever-increasing technological world by just going to the, you know, super cheap and then letting people figure out what they wanted to do within that sphere. So that's all really good. The Robinhood guys were very brave and very forward-thinking, and that's all wonderful. Except for a few things. One of the things that we have to worry about is there systemic risk as a result of what Robinhood has created that could really roll out on the rest of us? And there are some things going on out there that you guys don't know about that are behind the scenes with regard to Robinhood and all other brokers that are involved in a kind of wild and crazy momentum, as much fun as it seems like that is, and I'm such a fan. There are things that can happen. So first off, let's talk about what is the big picture here in terms of a market bubble. The stock market bubble happens when there's this big surge in prices over a relatively short period of time, and it's extreme escalation, right? It's not just like it's going up over time. It's extreme escalation, and a market bubble pop happens when there's a very quick decrease in those prices, or what is sometimes referred to as a crash. Now, the thing that's important about this is that the stock market does this without the help of any Robinhood investors or younger people jumping in there and really starting to play by a different set of rules. The stock market's perfectly capable of crashing all by itself, and it has done so regularly for 140 years. So really, let's not get too whacked out of shape about somebody coming in and finding a new way to crash it, because it's gonna crash anyway, just on the old ways. That's just how it works out there. And I think you kind of need to understand a little bit about why that is. It's that when companies, when people, we're human, right? When we start to see easy money being made by our friends and neighbors, we wanna get involved in it. We just can't help it. It sort of starts to spread virally down the neighborhood way before there were things like, you know, cell phones and internet. It would spread virally back in the 20s. It spread virally back in the 1960s. It spread virally back in the 1870s. It's just word of mouth, and it's just faster now. So we have more volatility than we used to. But we also have tools to kind of constrain it when it crashes. So we could see, for example, that the federal government didn't have the tools to constrain the stock market when it crashed in the 1929-1930 era. And the result was a wipeout. I mean, the market kept going down. It went down 90%. And that created a lot of fear, a lot of lost money. Then the banks failed on top of that. And then you had more fear. So now we have, you know, we haven't seen a bank failure take down their depositors for a long, long, long time, decades, and that's fantastic. So that's federal government rules and regulations in a good way. And market bubbles are much more under control now. In 2009, when the stock market crashed way down, there were extreme government actions to bring it back. And you saw how quickly it turned around in 2009 and started back up again. I mean, literally, it hit the bottom in March of 2009, and it was already moving up pretty solidly by the late spring in June. So that was pretty good. And then we saw this crash happen in March last year. And wow, did the government ever get cranked into that in a hurry? I mean, all sides of the government came together. And that stock market crash lasted like 3 weeks. I mean, it was just straight down, straight up. So it's really amazing how different the timing is now on the stock market crashes. But there's nothing amazing about a stock market crash. And basically, nobody knows what would cause one. It's always sort of the camel on the straw's back. It's always that sort of, it's never a straw. It's always like a brick on the camel's back, and the camel collapses and there it goes. And we never know what that brick is going to be. And if you want to read some good books about that, my favorites are written by Nicholas Taleb, who's a former options trader, super successful, who became, and this is an unusual transition in life, he became a professor at NYU. You don't see that very often. And by the way, he said that, in case some of you are thinking about becoming academics, he said, if you think it's rough in the Chicago Board of Exchange pits where they trade commodities, and it's very rough, the pits are full of people who used to be football players, he said, you should see the elbows get sharpened up in academia. It's really brutal. So anyway, Taleb's written several books about this kind of sort of the brick on the camel's back, what he would call a black swan, and how those events come along a lot more often than you'd ever imagine. So, okay, back to what we're at to figure out is whether this current batch of volatility creators and price manipulators over on Robinhood are really capable of creating a market crash. So one of the things that happened with GameStop, and this is a really cool example of investors that were not so much out for a big return as they were out to punish other investors. And this is unprecedented among little guys. It's very precedented. Is that even a word? It's precedented among guys who play in the institutional leagues, right? So hedge fund managers have tried to punish other hedge fund managers forever. And one of the most famous examples of hedge fund management punishing some really big guys happened in 1997, I think, or 1998, with a company called Long Term Capital, they were built by, I think, two Nobel Prize winners in modern portfolio theory, which since has come under a lot of fire, not in the least, maybe by me and all of the work we've been doing to absolutely destroy the concept of efficient market theory. Of course, I'm not getting a Nobel Prize for it. There have been several Nobel Prizes awarded by people who prove that efficient market theory is nonsense. And you can look at any number of these videos and we'll talk about that. But in 1997 or 98, this company, Long Term Capital, had billions of dollars under management. And they got attacked by hedge funds who were essentially discovered that they were long in a certain position or short of a certain position. Whatever they were wrong. And they got hammered by funds that came in there and pounded them. That's essentially what's happened here with GameStop, is that these GameStop buyers, this group of people on Reddit, jumped in there en masse to punish the very large short positions that they had discovered against the stock. Now, part of that was just that, hey, we like GameStop. Well, you know, many of us are gamers and we like GameStop, and we think it's being unfairly punished by the short sellers who are trying to drive it down, some of whom are trying to drive it into bankruptcy so they can profit from it going into bankruptcy. So there's some real bloody games going on here, and this group of individual little guys came in, teamed up, and forced the price up by buying aggressively with enough small guys that their total sum of dollars driving it up was huge. And the end result was at least one major hedge fund with $12 billion in capital on January 1st this year ended up at the end of January with under $6 billion of its own capital. It had $8 billion, but $2.5 billion of that was an infusion from some people that were very interested in protecting their friends and also trying to find a way to protect Robinhood. Now, this was the unexpected side of this that you may not know about, is that Robinhood, well, you may know about this, Robinhood came under a lot of fire and a lot of people quit Robinhood and went to other brokers because they saw Robinhood as supporting these big hedge funds by manipulating the trading going on in GameStop. And what they did to manipulate that was to make it impossible to keep buying it. And what they wanted to do essentially was drive the price down, or at least it looked like that, to drive the price down so these hedge funds could get a better exit from their short positions. Now, that isn't what Robinhood was trying to do. These are not guys who are in support of large hedge fund managers. They are pretty much the people you think they are. But because they're the people you think they are, that is young, not necessarily super sophisticated, billionaires who just made it faster than they could believe, they didn't realize how much the regulators were going to be looking over their shoulders as their obligations started to kick in to cover the short positions if the short hedge fund managers couldn't cover. All of a sudden, the Robinhood guys woke up one day and went, holy criminies, we could be on the hook for $2 or $3 billion here that we don't have, and figure it out. I mean, if the GameStop driving force from Reddit was driving that price up and these short positions couldn't cover in order, right? I mean, they just didn't have the money. All of a sudden, Robinhood could go after their houses and their cars and all that, but that's gonna take months, if not years. Meanwhile, the long guys, all the little guys, they wanna get paid. Hey, pay me. And in order to do that, somebody's gotta come up with the money. And if the hedge fund can't come up with the money, guess who does have to come up with the money? You heard it right, Robinhood does. And all of a sudden these 20-somethings were sitting there going, ah, where do we get this? And so they had to stop things kind of in its tracks. And this is sort of one of the systemic problems that happens when unexpected things happen. You have unexpected consequences or unintended consequences that can be rather severe. And so Robinhood shut down trading effectively in that stock for a little while. And meanwhile, that unintended consequence of this rather fun game of trying to crush some guys out there, crush some big guys, that rolled over into other brokerages, including the broker I trade at, which is Interactive Brokers, who basically shut down trading briefly in a number of these companies that had been identified on these Reddit bulletin boards. So, wow, the little guy roared and it rippled through the whole environment. And boy, these guys were out hustling money to get cash in. Robinhood quickly raised $2 or $3 billion. Well, kudos to them for being able to do it, but it cost them a lot of equity. So one of the unintended consequences of this mass targeting of a specific stock because it had been massively shorted by professionals who were perhaps operating not in the most fair sort of way was to create, almost destroying the very brokerage that was allowing this to go on. So this is really incredible. So can this crash the market? Oh, hell yeah. This is a brick. And you don't know which brick is going to land on the camel. That's the last brick. What you know is that the bricks are starting to stack up. Now, some of the bricks that are out there, you guys, are the fact that for the first time since 1999, when the market crashed dramatically, almost out of nowhere and almost for no reason, no apparent reason, the market is pricing all of these stocks out there at about a 2% yield, which is really flipping amazing. I mean, it's essentially like if you're going to play around in the stock market the way most people do, they're playing, they don't know what they're doing, they have to get a higher return than for the risk that they're taking compared to a T-bill, right? So right now, a 10-year T-bill is considered the risk-free rate. And typically the market is 5 or 6% above the 10-year T-bill. So the yield on the stock market right now should be, I don't know, 6%, maybe 5% to 6% conservatively, and it's 2%. So the market has bid up more than double what it should be reasonably compared to the earnings on all the companies that are in it right now. Now, maybe some of that is COVID, right? That the earnings aren't so high, but man, I don't know, lately, the earnings are kicking back in pretty strongly, and the earnings for a lot of companies in the S&P 500 have been phenomenal over the year as they have gone deeper and deeper into e-commerce. So yeah, can this, back to the original question, can a bunch of traders operating together do something for fun or profit without any intention whatsoever of crashing the very market they're trying to profit from or crashing the very broker that they're trying to profit in? Can that happen? And the answer is absolutely it can happen. What it takes for a market crash or any bubble to crash is just that the enthusiasm and I would almost say irrational exuberance that goes on in a bull market or in a bubble gets so high that the next step isn't more enthusiasm. The next step at that stage is less enthusiasm. You just can't get any more enthusiasm. There's no more people to be enthusiastic. There's no more money to chase it. It's as enthusiastic as it can get. And when that happens, then the enthusiasm starts to go sideways. It doesn't take long for people to start to exit. And when that happens, that cutting edge that's very sensitive to these changes in emotion, those guys start getting out. Often big hedge fund managers, they're more attuned to this sort of thing than anybody in the world. That's how they make their living. They start to exit with big dollars. And when those exits starts, then the prices begin to drop. Now, you've seen this in your lifetime because it happened in real estate back in 2006 and 2007 as people started, particularly the big guys who started to realize there was a problem with these bonds based on subprime real estate, they started to exit those bonds. And then that starts to let more people who are not quite as big or quite as knowledgeable pay attention and realize, oh, people are getting out of here. It's very much like watching some people leave the theater. First, just one or two, and you don't think anything about it. You just think they're gonna go get some popcorn, right? What people do all the time, they're just leaving. You don't realize they're leaving because they smell smoke. Your nose just isn't as attuned. So at what point do you start to realize there's an exodus going on? It doesn't take that long after those first few people start to go, before a number of people go. And when a number of people go, you realize, oh, this isn't people going to the bathroom, all right? So which is the brick? We know which person becomes the one that is the one, that one person wasn't there, you think it still could be a bathroom break. But when that one person is there, it's no longer a bathroom break. Nobody knows the answer to that. It's just a sense of it, and that sense starts to be extruding the feeling of danger, and then that feeling gets stronger, and then you act on it. And that's what crashes markets. So yeah, they can do it. Now, the beauty of Rule One Investing, just to put in one little plug for what we're teaching you guys, is that we should not be in the market for GameStop or anything else like a GameStop, or in fact, even perhaps in this market at all, unless you're in very specific stocks that are still underpriced, because in every market there's always something underpriced for sure. But realistically, a Rule One investor is going to exit way before we get to this place, right? We're not going to be in GameStop when it goes from 100 to 300. We have no business being in GameStop at 100 or even at 50. So just the sheer pricing relationship to value becomes so absurd that virtually every Rule One investor who's not asleep is out. And that's the same thing that happens with the market. So the edge that it gives you to understand value in the specific companies that you're looking at is gigantic. The biggest part of it is you're not going to get caught in big downturns in the market unless you absolutely have just gone on vacation without your computer. So you, and it won't even be a vacation, it'll be months before this whole thing tumbles and you're still stuck. So have confidence that you can do this, and you can make calls in this marketplace that the big pros can't make. They're too big to move around. Everything is being judged on a month-to-month basis. They can't play the same game the way we do or the way Buffett does. So I'll just give you I'll give you a quick warning though, real quick, just on a financial advisor type disclaimer. I'm not your financial advisor, number one. And to all the Robinhood investors and all these young investors in general who might be over your head with margin calls, options, investing more money than you possibly can afford, love to hear from you, but be careful out there. Really, please be careful. And so, you know, love to hear from you guys. What are you doing out there? What are your thoughts on these Robinhood investors and this, you know, in my view, massively overpriced market? So leave your comment below with your answer. I'll be sure and follow up with you. And now go play. See ya. If you enjoyed this video and you think it was valuable in teaching you more about whether or not Robinhood investors are creating a bubble all by themselves or maybe helping, hit the like button and please share the video with your friends. And by the way, if you want more investing content, just subscribe to my channel and don't forget to click the button on the screen for a free gift, you guys. Thanks again for watching.